Hi, I'm Hermine Mouth, and this is a video in the Heterogeneity series with a focus on gene-by-environment interaction. Credit for many slides goes to workshop faculty, including Sarah, Brad, Marlene, Connor, and others. By now, you're probably quite familiar with univariate genetic analyses, where we're interested in quantifying the contributions of genetic and environmental factors to the variance of a phenotype of interest. Here, we go a step further and ask questions about whether these contributions of genetic and environmental factors are equal for different groups or for different levels of covariates. Sarah, in a previous video, has introduced how to test for sex difference of different kinds. We focus here on a variety of other potential grouping variables. Now, of course, it's key to know group membership to be able to test the differences not only in the magnitude of the effects, but also in the nature of the effects. So typically, we're first interested whether the contributions are greater or smaller in one group versus another. So we call this quantitative effects because we're talking about the quantity or the magnitude of the effect. This can be done when we have concordant group membership for our grouping variable, which can be gender, nationality, environment, or even age or cohort, which are not necessarily measured in specific groups. If we also want to ask questions about the nature of the effects, in other words, whether the same or different genetic or environmental factors influence the trait in two groups, which we refer to as qualitative sex differences, we also need twin pairs that are discordant for group membership. Now, it's always important when we talk about a topic to go back to some of the classical papers on this topic. And inevitably, that leads us back to some papers by Professor Dr. Lindon who has written extensively about a variety of topics, including genotype, bioenvironmental interaction, and covariance, as the 1977 paper indicates, as well as his very extensive paper in 1978 on model fitting approaches to the analysis of human behavior that really lays the ground for work for a lot of the topics that are covered in this workshop. We will also talk a little bit about this Martin and Eves and Heat paper detailing the power associated with G by E interaction types of models. So let's start back with the classical Eves 1978 heredity paper, where he recognized that identical twins can form a natural experiment for studies of various kinds of G by E. He distinguishes between two forms of systematic non-additive effects, namely directional dominance, which we can estimate separately from the additive genetic effects that influence the variability in a phenotype, or genotype-environment interactions, defined as the sensitivity to environmental factors that is related in a systematic way to the average performance of the genotypes in a range of environments. In this paper, Eves also refers to the classic Jenkson-Fulker 1970 paper that recognized that the systematic genotype-environment interactions might be detected by investigating the form of the relationship between the mean scores and the within-pair standard deviations of monozygotic twin pairs. It's also important to recognize that that may also reflect errors of measurement. Here we highlight the main aspects of the Martin and Eves 1987 paper that talks about power to detect both the main effects of measured and residual genotype and measured and residual environmental factors and their two-way interactions. And does this both in the context of measuring a continuous trade or an index of liability, as well as affection status or a binary or ordinal measure. The paper also provides some information about testing for assumptions about ascertainment. Now, by now, you're pretty familiar with the standard ACE model. And when we fit this model, we assume that it holds in the population. Here is a well-known path diagram by now, where we not only are able to estimate the mean, but also the variance components of any phenotypic variable that we assume to be normally distributed with a mean mu and a variance as the sum of the variance components VA plus VE plus possibly VC or even VD. Now, what if there isn't one underlying population, let's say two, such as males and females? We can then not only investigate the main effect of this grouping by sex in this case on the phenotype, but we can also test the interaction effect of sex by either the additive genetic or the unique or even the shared environmental component. So sex is here considered a moderator, not just of the mean, but also of any of the variance components, where we ask the question whether the variance components are of equal magnitude in males versus females. And the same can be done for the environmental variance components. If heterogeneity exists in the population but is ignored, the estimates of both the mean and the variance components will be biased. So it's important to include the source of heterogeneity or the moderator into the model. And we do this in a multi-group model when the moderator is binary, or a moderation model when the moderator is continuous. Let's talk a bit more about the background between genotype and bioenvironment interaction and how we can test for it. Here we present the homoskedastic model, where we've plotted the phenotypic scores on the genetic scores, at the genetic level scores on the additive genetic variance component. And you see that in this figure, the environmental dispersion is the same for every level of A, or the environmental effects are the same given any value of A. So there is no heterogeneity. We call this the homoskedastic model. In contrast, here we see that the environmental dispersion changes or becomes greater with higher levels of the genetic variance. And so here we have the environmental effects systematically varying with the genetic factors. And we call this genotype by environment interaction or genetic control of sensitivity to different environments, or heteroskedasticity. We can also reverse this and plot the phenotypic scores on the environmental level. And if we note, as in this case, a genetic dispersion, or where the genetic effects systematically vary with the environmental effects, this is another form of G by E, in this case, environmental control of genetic effects. Now we can think of this more generally, where instead of plotting either the A or E scores on the x-axis and the phenotypic scores on the y-axis, we now have any kind of measured moderator, which we denote by M, on the x-axis, and look at the dispersion not only of the additive genetic variance, but also of the unique environmental and even possibly the shared environmental variance. So in this case, we have plotted the additive genetic factors, which seem to systematically vary with the measured moderator. And as I said, we can test this for each of the different variance components. So So when we talk about genotype by environment interaction, it can refer both to genetic control of sensitivity to the environment, as well as to environmental control of gene expression. And here are some examples. So we can ask whether the heritability of IQ depends on socioeconomic status, whether the heritability of ADHD changes as a function of age, or whether the genetic variance for drinking depends on parental monitoring. It's important to distinguish gene by environment interaction from gene environment correlation, which refers to either the genetic control of exposure to the environment or environmental control of gene frequency. And here, the examples fall into one of three possible types of RGE. When children with high IQ tend to read more books, that is a form of active RGE. When high IQ parents give their children more books to read, that is conceived as passive RGE. And then finally, when children with ADHD are treated differently by their parents, this can be a form of reactive or evocative RGE. First, we're going to talk a little bit more about using the multi-group approach to test for genotype by environment interaction when we have a binary moderator. So the main question we're addressing here is the magnitude of genetic influences on the trait the same in two or more groups? Or in other words, is the VA variance in group one equal to the VA variance in group two? Some examples are, of course, what you've seen in Sarah's presentation. When the additive genetic factors are moderated by sex, we call this also sex by A interaction. Or we can have the genetic variance moderated by marital status, as in this example by a paper by Andrew Heap that we'll go into a little bit more detail about, or A moderated by religious upbringing. Now, these are all examples where A gets moderated, so it's gene by environment interaction. But as I said before, we can potentially also moderate the other variance components, which is also done in these example papers. So first of all, this paper by Andrew Heath in twin research in 1998, looking at the interaction of marital status and genetic risk for symptoms of depression. Andrew also lays out very nicely the various different models and the specific hypotheses that are tested by each of these models. And they found that a marriage-like relationship seems to act as a protective factor in reducing the impact of inherited liability to symptoms of depression in the general population. Our next example is another binary moderator, in this case, whether one has experienced a religious upbringing and how that impacts the genetic variance of various personality traits, including this inhibition. And you see here that especially in the males, in those that are receiving a religious upbringing, the genetic influence of the genetic factors is substantially reduced for this disinhibition trait compared to those males that are raised in non-religious families. Now, as I indicated before, these types of gene by environment interaction models cannot only be applied where we have a two-group situation, such as males and females, or married or unmarried, or having an exposure or not. But in some cases, the moderator of interest can have many categories, such as socioeconomic status or education. And some variables are even continuous. So we're interested in whether there is a continuous trend of the proportions of variance as a function of the moderator. If we were to group these variables into high and low categories, we would lose a lot of information. So we're really focused here now on testing whether the magnitude of genetic and environmental variance components changes linearly with the moderator. Now, a quick word about terminology, because we talk a lot about G by E, where E is typically referred to as the environment, but here we're thinking of E more in as a moderator. So this, in principle, could be a macro environmental moderator, which is the typically the unmeasured or the random variation that we capture with the E and the C components in our twin models. But more likely, we're talking about a macro environment or a measured moderator, such as SES, life events, exposure, or smoking. Although one might ask questions about whether smoking is an environmental variable. More about that later. It's also important to recognize whether these environments or these measured moderators are independent of the genotype or potentially correlated with the genotype, either of the individual or their relative, and where we have to potentially take into account the processes of gene-environment correlation, as well as testing for G by E interaction. And so in most of these instances, we assume that the moderator is an environmental variable. It turns out, however, that a lot of the so-called environmental measures that people have used in epidemiological research for years also display some genetic variance. And this was also noted by Plomin Bergman in 1991 and in the Kendler and Baker paper in 2006, where they looked at a variety of environmental measures and applied a basic twin analysis and found that genetic influences on measures of the environment seem to be rather pervasive in extent, but modest to moderate in impact. And so it's important to recognize that when including moderators in the analyses. This presentation, of course, owes a lot to the early work of Dr. Lindon, who unfortunately passed away this year. And so if you want to learn more about his life and his career as a geneticist and as a behavioral scientist, feel free to find a remembrance here on our VIPBG website. So thank you, everyone, and thank you, Lindon.